Call to order if we could at 6:30. Tonight we have the South County Senior Center Director Marlene Johnson to talk about all the good things that happened in the senior center and their budget presentation as well, which is, that's easy enough. We hope to meet with Sergeant Brendan Lyons, talk about an officer in charge agreement as well as the schedule for staffing. Here comes that feedback again. Is that out? Yes, she did. Nope, not yet. Okay, and then we have selectmen's updates, the town administrator's updates, a couple of appointments, as well as other important dates and reminders. So if we could start, I hear the humming is gone. Nice, thanks very much. We can start, Marlene Johnson, director of the South County Senior Center. First of all, thanks for everything you do. And now we can talk about all the good stuff that goes on there.
Okay.
Including your budget presentation.
Okay.
Thanks.
Great. Alrighty. So let's see, I've been there at the center as their director since 2015 of November. Mm-hmm. And we have done a lot of cleaning, revamping, adding different programs. We started just recently to open on Tuesdays, sort of unofficially open but still open, where we would have programs, presenters, different other presentations come on Tuesdays. So trying to schedule programming on a Tuesday, because I'm there most of the time anyway at that time. We've also have added programming from 1 to 3 on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. Still does not interfere with our regular morning programs and lunch program that we offer. Instead of just having a social at 1, we are now including programs. We have belly dancing, which is going to start. That's an 8-week. Anyone interested in belly dancing, more than welcome to come down on a Tuesday at 1 o'clock. And for that, and then we're also going to have a watercolors. Actually, it's the watercolors that starts this Tuesday next month at 1, and the belly dancer is going to be on Mondays at 1. For the next 3 months. That's how that works. So those
you
are
don't
just
want the watercolor and the belly dancer at the same time.
No.
Yeah, right. I kind of put them in there together. It's like, whoops, I don't think so.
So it's really a figure drawing class, right?
Yeah, it's the exactly belly dancer. Yeah, really. Like, yeah. So those are just some of the things that are happening, you know, with the center at this point.
And those are on top of traditional programs?
Our traditional programs that we have, the exercise on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays.
Nice.
We still have the Tai Chi,
mm-hmm.
The osteo class, the yoga class, osteo and Tai Chi on Fridays. And we still have the bingo on Fridays.
Nice.
And then we have the cribbage tournament once a month. And, you know, everyone still plays cribbage. And
mm-hmm.
We still have the lunch. And I offered to do an art class on Mondays, so that's working pretty well.
That sounds like a great schedule.
Yeah, it's pretty good. It's getting there. You know, I like to have Thursdays more, but we have the cleaning in the afternoon, and that's been kind of a traditional thing for him to come in, and we have the yoga in the morning, which takes about like an hour and a half, yeah. And that gives me time to do my paperwork,
right.
And, you know, kind of hang out.
Because as fun as the program sound, there's always the paperwork. It never stops.
There is. For small senior center. There's a lot going. There are people coming and going and coming and going. And yeah, there's a lot.
So Tom's brought back in over the past couple of years now, really kind of the live reports about attendance and et cetera.
Yeah,
and,
updated.
Yeah,
what I did is I checked on our my senior center space to find out what we have. We average about 60 to 70 seniors a week on an average that come who are active. I mean, there's a lot of other seniors that you know, will pop in, will not punch in, you know, or sign their cards, stuff of that nature. But the ones who are, we have about between 60 and 70. That's on a weekly basis. Last year, we had an average about 200 active seniors on a regular basis. Hopefully now, with adding extra programs and adding extra programs on Tuesday, that will increase, even if it's duplicates, that will increase, you know, participation.
Yeah.
Because it's one more day added, or one more hour added on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. So that pretty much is, you know, like I said, it's an average of how that works.
Nice. Tom or Dave, you want to weigh in?
You can tell which ones are new as opposed to like existing ones. So we're coming up with that, right,
yeah,
through the system?
Yeah, yeah, as we're doing it, what I have, my program assistant, Sue Corey, who does a wonderful job.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, she's very good. I have her, anytime we have anyone new that they need to give me a copy of their application so I can put it in our file. So when I do my annual report, which I just gave, this is my monthly, I can actually tell you who we had, how many, I broke it down from, how many from Waitley were new, Sunderland.
Okay.
Yeah, right here it says, let's see, we have within the three towns, okay, we had 35 new participants from January to December of last year. Eight of them were from Sunderland, six Waitley, 13 from South Deerfield, and six participants from Greenfield, and one from Mills Falls and Conway.
Oh, nice. That's
good.
So the word is out.
Yeah. So since January to now, to present, we've had 10 new people. So I just put that in a monthly report.
That's great.
10 new people have joined.
I had the opportunity during the review, interview process, to spend a bit of time over summer. It was a neat experience. Got to meet a lot of interesting people and see how everything worked. It was very good.
Yeah. We moved from paper plates to plates.
Thank
that
you.
Went over really well. I was surprised. I'm like, really? Yeah. So now we're going to be using real plates starting next month and real. So it's all those little additives, you know, those little home necessities.
That's right. And there was something to be said about the soft touch associated
with
that. There's something truly homey about that.
Yeah.
That's great.
It's nice.
Huh?
Well, Marlene knows better than anyone. We have to be very careful when anything changes.
Yeah, that's why I said, I looked at Tom because it was like, okay, how are we going to get this in? Yeah.
And experienced that this summer, too.
Well, there's a certain level, I think, our regulars, there's a certain level of expectations for when they come in. They like the stability of things being a certain way. The good thing is that no change is just foisted upon the group. I mean, usually there's a conversation, there's a discussion, and it's kind of occurs over a period of time. Asking about people that attend, we have a code of ethics that when people come, they sign. So there's a level of expectation that we all want for the we don't want. Sometimes maybe in the past, one or two people may have tried to run the show.
You mean strong personalities.
Strong personalities.
So we did, and you know, and they don't probably want to do that either. So we have a code of ethics. There's that people sign in. For a lot of reasons, we don't actually know who's there. I mean, the board of directors or anybody. Marlene, if she has to know, she can find out.
Mm-hmm.
But it's good to keep track because there's a lot of documentation that Marlene and the staff have to maintain for the state,
especially
for the grants that
yes.
we get.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we try to encourage people to sign in. We know the facility is a building that's owned and maintained by the town of Deerfield, and they've been fantastic with that. There are some areas that we're trying, that they're working on getting changes. Some changes are being made, which is good.
You mean to the building proper, physical changes?
Well, we are having, I had some people come in for estimates for a new flooring.
Oh, good.
For the main area, the kitchen area, and the sitting area, I guess that you could call it. And the maintenance came in, and he took them, and he'll go further and, you know, figure out who can come in, and we'll arrange, you know, to get new flooring, which would be a start.
But there's little things, like furniture and...
We have nice furniture now.
And we get caught between trying to ensure that we have furniture that's sturdy enough. For the people that use, but at the same time, it's in a condition that they can move it more easily if they... And so there's a lot of things that you try to balance, so, right? You know, the meals they have there are excellent meals. They still have a brown bag program on...
The first Thursday of the month over at the town hall.
Yeah.
The first Thursday of the month?
Yeah.
And I would say if there's someone from Sunderland that has trouble getting to the senior center, or...
We've done grand responses for them, for the PVTA. We have someone coming Wednesday from Sunderland who needs a demand response, so we'll get her on the PVTA, you know, so she can make her doctor's appointment in 2 weeks.
Yep.
So.
And if you'd like to participate in the brown bag and you can't get there for whatever reason, if you call Marlene at the senior center...
We will make sure they will get it.
Marlene can make sure. Marlene, you want to give the telephone number?
665-2141.
You can call Marlene and leave a message, or talk to Marlene or Sue. They can get your information, your address, and they can make sure those brown bags are delivered also. So, and a lot of that done through Atlas Farm. So we want to plug Atlas.
Oh, don't forget our farm stand Friday from Atlas Farms. Yeah, yeah, they donate cream, butter, yogurt. Received. Right now we're just like root vegetables, beets, potatoes, ginger.
So, tis the season right now.
Yeah, yeah.
So again, I would say there are many things that are going on. And as Marlene said earlier, she is there on days that the senior center's not open, working on paperwork and such. So if you'd like to come over, again, you can give her a call, you can email her on Tuesdays or Thursdays and come over and see her, and you can look around. You can actually sit down with Marlene and review what they have to offer. Because we can't cover everything. Or you may have an idea of what you want to do, or what you like. You may have a talent that you want to share, and bring it over also. So, some people come once a week. Some people come twice a week. Some people come three times a week. Some people go once a month.
Right, and we've had some people like call and come by on a Tuesday and Thursday. I was there, you know, wanting to know what we have offered. You know, especially the Tai Chi and the yoga. And,
So I would definitely recommend giving a call and spending and going over to see. It's not, you know, it's difficult because we call it a senior center. It is a senior center on all intents and purposes.
It is a senior center.
But
yeah.
I guess if you were to think what a senior center was 30 years ago and what it's today, it's totally different. It's totally different. And also there's many, many, many people in our communities, the three communities that help through financial donations, through donations of time or donations of material. I know, like, it's coming up in springtime, the seniors go out and decorate around the building, so we're always taking, looking if somebody wants to donate plants or flowers.
We're having a big town event with Yankee Candle volunteers are gonna come throughout the town, and they're going to put flowers in the, near the library, our place. We'll have brown bag combined. This is gonna be June 14th, and then we're gonna put some flags around, so it's gonna be a really big event. Coming up in July 6th, we're having our senior barbecue.
Nice.
Where we'll have the towns, you know, we'll send out invitations for everyone.
You know anybody who can operate a, know anybody who can operate a smoker?
I was gonna say, yeah, you might know somebody.
Well, that would be good if we know someone.
Yeah.
Where we have a barbecuer. And we have someone going out inviting, you know, and getting donations and stuff. But a smoker would be kind of cool too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
David.
Might have to get the band back.
Well, we'll have to call you. Yeah.
Well, Paul, it's nice to have what sounds like really good energy at the space, active programs, committed people, and participants, you know? Mm-hmm. Having committed folks to a large empty room where it's got a program, doesn't make it quite so much fun. I'm looking at, I have one question specific to the budget. It is pretty straightforward on the expense side and the town apportionment to the three towns that participate. But there's a big category under grants. And my question was more a global question, not one about a specific grant.
Right.
Is there pressure on these, how many of these grants are annual, and is there pressure on those grants in the current budget cycle at the state level, do you know?
Yeah, our SIG grant,
yep.
Just recently, talking with Emma at the state level, he says they're trying to get it, instead of renewing it every year, to have it, I mean, every year you have to do this and that, but to have it for the 3 years, because it is a three-year,
okay.
It is a three-year grant, and getting all your contracts,
yep.
All at the same time, mm-hmm. Instead of waiting 1 year for this and 1 year for that, mm-hmm. Since it's not a yearly thing, it's, you know, based on 3 years. The Title III grant, we had no problem with it, just renewed itself.
Okay.
Right, I just had to finish doing some evaluations around it, mm-hmm. And some more characteristic reports and an APIS report. I just sent that out, mm-hmm. for the end of the fiscal year, beginning of the fiscal year, October, November, and December. And now just working on a new NAPLIS report for January, February, March,
okay.
Which that will be finished. And then our Formula 3 grant, which I understand, Tom, I think it is, it's a yearly as well. That one is a little unclear. And that is just our basic operating expense, salaries, you know, expenditures, you know, different things of that nature for that.
Well, I would certainly hope that the state, which sends out the reports about the demographics and the aging demographics, mm-hmm. You know, the pressures on age in place and all of the things we talk about with our population graying, recognizes that the importance of those grants to centers as well.
Right, yeah, I mean, like the SIG grant, that was kind of held up between, you know, Baker, you know, taking office and, mm-hmm. You know, I mean, Emmett said that he had the approval letters on his desk for at least 3 months before he could, you know, his boss had to sign off of them, and she was waiting for the approval from, you know, at the upper hand. So that one was kind of, you know, a little iffy about that. So, but it went through, and, you know, we're just waiting for, you know, the contracts to come in and stuff. And he said they should be in probably by April. So.
Well, thanks. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
I see that as an area of concern, because those cover programs or direct costs, or
mm-hmm.
If something happens to them, they have to be either infilled or the program or the element they support becomes in jeopardy. You know, we don't want that to happen, especially with all the things that are going on that are really positive.
Right.
Okay. Tom, David, anything else with respect to the senior center? So we have an application of 62,802 total, and then Sunderland's portion is like 15,701.
Thanks and keep up the great work. Yeah, it's been going really well. So,
anything else, Tom?
Well, Marlene's been doing a tremendous job. She's we mentioned the other day that we're looking for an outreach coordinator. We're still looking for an outreach coordinator. So someone in the range of this voice can interested in becoming an outreach coordinator for the.
I think we're getting supposed to be getting the fight the committee together to.
Yeah.
It's in a process. It's a process.
But that's coming forward. We've been lucky the last four, five, 6 years. We've had each of our directors has been able to build, has brought a different skill set to the position, and has built upon the other skill sets that preceded them. And I think Marlene continues that tradition. She has a much different skill set, I think, than our past administrators, our directors. So I'm looking for, and things take a while to get off the ground, we all understand that, but and again, just listen to some of the things that she's talked about are good things. So it'll keep people interested and in changing, and what I would say in the next couple of years, we should see big things.
Oh, yeah. You know what they say about changes. You change when no one wants a change, or when a change isn't needed. Yeah, well, you know, when a change isn't needed, you know.
I think pretty much a lot of the change is, the best change is the change that's unfelt while it's going on.
Yes, yes. And I think so far it has been. Because like you said, we do talk and we do ask, what do you think of this? And our seniors, what do you think of this? And they seem to be doing well with them.
And the Board of Oversight has talked with Marlene in our meetings and expressed how we feel it's very important for the director to be hands-on and be out with the clients, and we have had nobody has said that that's not what Marlene's doing, so.
Yeah, we don't spend a lot of time in the office. It's kind of small. I don't know how anything's going to be. You have to get out and run around. Get coffee, chat, you know. I wish I could chat all day.
That's great stuff. Such fun. Any questions of us? You get one shameless plug here on TV about how good the board's treating you and Sunderland's awesome.
Oh, yeah. Sunderland's awesome. Tom and
Tom's great.
Yeah. Scott. Sherry's been helpful. And David. I met him at the mall.
Well, thanks so much, Marlene, for all you do. And with respect to the budget, you know, again, we pay a minority position in the senior center, and, you know, choose to participate at all those levels.
Mm-hmm.
It's certainly a win for all the participants.
Yeah.
Worth every penny plus.
Yep. And I like it. I like it very much. So
okay.
I'm glad I'm here.
Well, thanks for coming to see us tonight.
Okay,
have a great night.
All right, you too.
Okay, next up we've got minutes of March 7th in front of us.
Make a motion on those.
Second.
It was a short meeting. We still end up with two pages.
I know.
Okay, we have a motion being seconded for the minutes of March 7th. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. Okay, we have a letter of resignation in front of us as well.
This is dated March 8th from John Broder to the town of Sunderland. I'm writing to inform you that I will be resigning from my position as patrolman with the Sunderland Police Department. My last shift will be Thursday, March 17th, 2016. I have accepted a full-time position with the Agawam Police Department. Today, providing with a start date of March 20th, 2016, I would like to extend my sincere thanks to the town of Sunderland and the Sunderland Police Department. both have provided me with wonderful opportunities, and I have grown exponentially as a police officer. I wish the department and my fellow officers the best of luck in the future. Respectfully submitted, Patrolman John Broder.
Okay, is there a motion to accept the resignation?
Motion.
Second. Motion's made and seconded to accept the resignation of full-time officer John Broder, and wish him luck, wish him the best going to a department closer to home.
Yep.
All those in favor?
Aye.
2-0, please. Okay, one more correspondence here. We have the registrar's request from the town clerk. Might be there's some election stuff happening.
I heard something about that. Just noise in the background.
Some of it is.
It's gonna be huge.
Exactly.
This is to the Board of Selectmen from Wendy Hu, town clerk, regarding registrar's appointments. Please appoint the following to the Board of Registrars for the following expiration dates. Judith Richards, 3/15/2017. Edward Kelly, 3/15/2018. Donald Patterson, 3/15/2019. Please feel free to contact me if you have any questions, and thank you.
Motion.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion made and seconded to appoint registrars as presented by the town clerk. All those in favor?
Aye.
3-0, please. Thank you, town clerk. Okay, just a couple more minutes here before 7 o'clock appointment. If we could maybe go through the board updates, and then we'll move on to our 7 o'clock appointment. I'll save the best for last year, town administrator updates. with respect to the one that I would say I'm working on closest is the waiting for the final update on the grant round to provide us with assistance for design developer for 120 North Main. That continues to progress, and we're anticipating that confirmation pretty darn soon. And that'll be hopefully as we are going into town meeting. That may not be actionable at town meeting, but that's okay. Design developer.
Get it rolling.
Yeah. It's important to keep some momentum on there. It has been several months. That's really all I have at this point. Tom, anything?
Well, I want to make Eversource mad at me again.
have they called yet?
Well, the last email that we got from them, they did not sound pleased what I had to say about them, that they were going to get right back to us, unless
you're
I missed it.
Counter your points.
Unless I missed the drift of emails or the appointment on our calendar, it doesn't look like Eversource is here to talk to us yet.
Not yet. I didn't see any emails.
I have a meeting with Ken tomorrow.
Oh, did? Ooh.
It's an introduction.
I'm sure the topic will come up, yes.
Huh?
Yep. I'm sure we'll talk.
So my point is, if this was really important to Eversource, it would have been done by now.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not. My guess is that they're doing it because as a public utility, the state, if they didn't do it, the state would probably beat them up. But right now, they can claim a lot of things are interrupting or slowing the process down. And my guess, I should be able to have an opinion, because I don't see Eversource right in front of me right now, is that it's not advantageous to get us the interconnect agreement and everything so that we can actually do our solar projects. But it's not just us. It's holding up. They're holding up residents.
Oh, a lot of residents, yes.
And a lot of things. So they're holding up other communities. It's not just our community, it's other communities as well. At some point, it's going to have to stop. We will talk to our legislators, and whatever leverage they can use.
Yes, Steve was well informed of how we felt when he came here that Saturday in the library. So there were a lot of people, a lot of good topics were brought up at that session.
Right. So Eversource may have a problem what was said from this seat on this board, but just so Eversource know, in case they're monitoring our communications now, just so they know, there's people in the communities that are very upset with them as well. So. I mean, and I'm probably one of the kinder ones towards Eversource. So, anyway, so Eversource, Come and see us. Still waiting, we're still waiting for you. I'm waiting patiently to see you sitting here in front of me and telling you why we can't do what you're required to do by law.
Great points.
That's all.
That's it.
Yeah.
Tom, excuse me, David, anything else?
There should be official announcements coming, but we reached agreement on our teachers for Youth Union 38, our instructional assistant, so.
So the formal announcement will be coming out?
Yeah, they should be making the formal.
Et cetera.
Right, exactly. So wrapped that up last Wednesday.
Yeah, so Dave, when do we start?
Yes, that's right.
Well, thanks for your work on that.
It was a long one this time.
Right, they're not always that easy. They can be prickly because the topics are prickly.
Yep.
That's just the way it is. And then we go in with an adult tone, which is almost always the case. Sometimes not in the same meeting, usually over the course of the whole thing, it works out. Well done. Okay, any other board updates? If not, we have 7:05, 7:01:31. Come on up, Sergeant Lyons.
Patiently waiting back.
He's right on time.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, thanks so much. There's a couple of things in front of us, Brendan. One, we got today the OIC agreement from Dave Jenkins with the requested changes. You take a look at that and let me know if there's anything that we have not talked about. And if you're still interested in being the OIC, we can act on that tonight. There were three changes. One was about moving in the event of when the return to your current position as sergeant is still spelled in there as sergeant, not just being able to return. And then I think the last piece in there was the area of concern was about the disciplinary functions and how that could work using the the board, because we're the second tier anyway, frankly. And then we are also going to talk about the schedule and a recommendation on your part. We know we have accepted tonight Officer Berdor's resignation, and of course with an opening of a working chief as well as now a patrolman after the 17th, there's some tension associated with filling a position and our recruiting hiring policy. So we knew, the office knew last week upon receipt of, what did it say, the 8th, the 18th, 18th? I guess it would have been the 8th. So we actually posted the position internally so that we stay inside the framework of our appointment selection process. And that's really important. But that doesn't mean we're still missing effectively two full shifts.
Not currently, no.
Right.
And all the other part-timers have stepped in and helped out to fill all the vacant shifts since the chief stepped down, so project went right along.
Very good. Any questions about the OIC piece, anything that we missed?
No, this looks great.
Okay, is there any questions of the board about the OIC agreement? Again, this is a officer in charge agreement that is the duties of the officer in charge for the department while there's a chief's opening. And when the chief's opening is filled, however that position is filled, obviously through hiring, Sergeant Lyons can return to the sergeant position if that's the direction he takes, with no loss of seniority, no loss of privilege in the bargaining unit, no loss of any of that.
Right.
That was kind of an interesting tension between, can you stay inside of the union and be a quasi-manager, or can you not be in the union and be a quasi-manager? And we have the town legal and the union legal had two different opinions, but it sounds like there may be some language that we worked toward. Tom, what do you think?
I know I'm a member of a union, and I have people under this in the union that are subordinate that if I had to have discipline, I believe I would be able to, and again, it's like first or second level.
Yep.
I have no doubt that Sergeant Lyons could handle, if, let's be honest and straight up about what we talk about in our union grievances.
Sure.
Our union grievances are pretty straightforward. We have maybe about who gets what shift. I don't think you guys have a shift whatever you call it, until, when's that?
Shipment occurs in May.
May.
Yeah, you can post it in May.
And that's pretty much a pretty straightforward.
That's an annual schedule.
Right. So that's a pretty straightforward, basically done on seniority, and we know what senior, and we know who's senior in the department. That's pretty straightforward. I think the other biggest ones that we have, I don't remember really contentious.
None of the.
Reasons. Their interpretation of the contract. Basically, I think they're all the interpretations of contracts. Mm-hmm. And if we don't solve it at the if it's not solved in either the way we like or the union likes or the chief likes, we usually talk about it in the next round of negotiations of the contract anyways. So.
Yes, those grievances are kind of antecedents for change in the contract.
Right.
From both sides, as a matter of
yeah.
fact. You know, they end up being something that wasn't necessarily covered, that has to be explored through the process, and as you said, comes back around.
Yeah. And so I'm pretty sure Brendan could have handled anything if anything came up anyways. So I really wasn't concerned about that. Brendan's a sworn officer. Means that if he is on duty and one of the members of the union is found to be in violation of whatever, he's going to treat that person the same way as you in or out of the union. Doesn't matter. They're sworn officers of the law. So I'm sure Brendan would have done that. So I don't, that's Brendan. I really didn't think that was a problem.
I think that most of the times grievances can be totally avoided with communication.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Great point.
Sitting down and talking to the officers and working our way through it.
We have a very good police department, in my opinion. I can't think of anything that we haven't been able to solve pretty easily over the last 10, 12, 14, 16 years, however long it's mm-hmm. been. We've been able to work out pretty easily. I'm not saying everybody goes away happy, but there's a solution. And if it has to be changed, it's changed.
Good point, Tom, actually. So, Ben, I think inside that OIC agreement that would hold you back from us acting on it tonight?
No, I don't believe so.
Okay. So, if that's the case, is there a motion of the board? Please take the time to review. This has been to council twice.
I'd like to make a motion to appoint Sergeant Lyons as our OIC, according to the memorandum agreement that we have in front of us.
Second. Okay, we have a motion being seconded to appoint Brendan OIC until the chief's position is filled. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0, please. Brendan, thanks so much. I really have enjoyed working with you on that.
Yep. Scotty, do you want to sign this?
Yeah, we're going to sign it. Get a signed copy of it.
Brendan?
We'll get one of them. Okay, Brendan, as we go progress while we go about the pen part of this, is there a plan with respect to is there reason to discuss tonight the resignation? We've got a week left, essentially. Well, this week, officer retires, moves on. And then we have another couple of days left of the posting, mm-hmm. and then the recommendation will come forward, say, at our next meeting. It'll be a week from today.
I don't think the 15 days will be up by next Monday.
Okay.
Yeah,
the next meeting. Okay, great. So it'll be two meetings.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great.
Yes,
so this one for you as well, then, if you could. Okay, we'll make sure you get a copy of that as well. Anything else for the cover?
Okay. Do you want to do a second copy so he can?
Yeah, he can actually take one. That's a good point.
Why don't we just all sign it? That what he has with him tonight. Yep. There's no question.
Yep.
Or Brendan could take that one and we could sign that.
Yeah, there's two copies right there. He's got one in the folder. We have one. We can sign them all.
So just sign that one, Brendan. We'll be all set.
Good. Probably gonna do it at some point.
That's a top decision, making $50 an hour. That's probably the one you...
That's the one you want.
That's just funny.
It always, like, any acceptance of more responsibility, the compensation never seems like it's nearly enough. Anything else you want to go over tonight? Again, we'll wait for schedule for 2 weeks. We know the schedule, you said, is filled in for the month of March. We talked before about the inevitable tension between filling schedules and available remaining appropriation. We've done that homework, and we're well within that appropriation
in
the current scheme. And that's a good place to be, actually.
Mm-hmm. It's always good to have extra money. But I even worked on today, the last 2 weeks of March, with John leaving, filling his shifts, and we're still well ahead of the game.
Okay.
Fairly wise.
Any comments from the board? Or anything you want to go over yet?
I did have one more item, please, if I could.
Sure.
I'm working with the Franklin County Sportsman's Club in Deerfield. Mm-hmm. They have an indoor firing range, and I'm trying to set up a low light shooting. Mm-hmm. Because to be honest with you, we haven't had it in probably 15 years.
Yep.
And it's something that we should really be doing every year.
Mm-hmm.
However, in order for us to use their facility, the Sportsman's Club is asking that they be added to our general liability insurance.
The common practice, Sherry?
That would make sense. As a contractor.
I would have to supply them with a certificate of insurance just stating that they've been added.
Okay. Yeah, if you want to work with Sherry in the morning, we can...
Okay.
Again, it's pretty common practice as a contractor vendor. In this case here, I'm sure they want to just carry it forward. General liability.
Okay, great.
Additionally insured. As long as it's not for $25 million.
No, one million.
Okay, that's easy.
Overall from River Road?
Yeah, by the railroad yard, yes.
Yep. Nice. Okay, Brendan, thank you. I look forward to continue working with you. I deeply appreciate you coming in tonight.
Thank you, Brendan.
All right, thank you.
So our next meeting here is the 21st at 6:30.
Town Administrator update.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to get to the next call. I wasn't going to forget it. I said the best for last. Genuinely meant last. So we're here for the 21st at 6:30. And it's important to bear in mind that those negotiations with Sergeant Lyons on the OIC took time, and it was important to benefit both the town as well as Sergeant Lyons. Okay, now here's where the minutes come from.
I feel like I should have something epic.
After all that buildup, right? It's like,
I continue to work on the budget and updating numbers, revenues. I attended several meetings. We had a police chief search committee kickoff meeting.
Oh, good.
We have a 300th anniversary committee kickoff meeting on Wednesday. I'll be attending a citizens planner training on Saturday at Holy Cross, and that's for complete streets and for 40B.
Yep.
We've unofficially heard that we were funded for the PATH grant. We're just waiting for the formal announcement. That should be coming any time.
I would just like to mention at this time, if it wasn't for Sherry, I don't know if we'd be involved in the community
pathways
yeah. program at
no.
all.
Compact.
So, Sherry, thank you. Those are monies that we would not be realizing right now. So thank you very much.
You're welcome. Hopefully there's more to come.
Well, I would just say it helps.
And yeah, absolutely.
It helps. And if anything will make our proposals more complete, more game ready, more acceptable for maybe bigger grants. So thank you.
That raises a good point, Tom. Oftentimes it can be lost, we call it back room work or the background work required. We found that out in an unfortunate fashion during the 40B discussions.
we applied for a park grant, and we were just, you know, a year and a half out of an expired open space and rec plan. Like, ah, grrr.
Yeah, having all your plans and all your tools ready to go when the opportunity presents itself is so important.
So that's foundational work.
Right, to echo, that's a good way to put it, foundational work. To echo Tom's point, Sherry, thanks so much. I think we have to have a meeting about your review, by the way. It's okay.
Well, along those lines too, that's why for our Franklin County Selectmen's Association, I actually sent out a special invite to, because our first meeting is about community compact. So I sent a special invite to town administrators.
Oh, good.
Yeah, because we want, because really, along with the Board of Selectmen, they're really the other key players in, you know, you have to have them involved, obviously. So it's an important thing, so.
Nice.
I talked to the Orange Town Administrator, they'll be there, and Athol, I believe, so.
Perfect.
I can just say, 19 years ago, 20 years ago, Sunderland hired a gentleman on a peer-to-peer grant by the name of John Pepin from, at the time, I don't know if you've ever run into John Pepin. He was a town administrator from Harvard at the time. He went to the dark side for it. We see him in Boston all the time. He actually went to the dark side. He was a school business manager for a short time, but he came back. He couldn't handle the dark side. But 20 years ago, Sunderland was having the conversation about the need for a town administrator. It was a pretty divisive conversation in our town. I would say that over the years, the town administrators, we've been very fortunate, have all helped us grow. Just like our senior center directors, each have brought something different to the table, professionalism, that has helped our town grow and maintain a path. Not to say we can always stay on the path, but we're on a path. So, again, but our town had that conversation.
Right.
Some towns are afraid to have the conversation. And I guess good things do come from, and not to say I'm comparing it to our present political environment, but it's okay to have a conversation. And it's okay to have different opinions. The only thing not okay is not listening. So if you have a concern, or you have a problem, or you have an idea, bring it forward, and we'll listen, we'll comment. You may not like what we hear, but that's okay, because we'll keep exchanging ideas until we get to, we can both hopefully agree on something.
That's, I think, the key thing that's missing is, like you said, it's okay to have different opinions, but in the end, somehow you have to come to a resolution and a compromise to resolve the issue, or solve the problem, or whatever. And that's something that seems to be missing from a lot of processes and dialogues these days, is figuring out how to solve a problem, and not digging in your heels and realizing that, you know what, there's more than one way to solve a problem, and not every way is always right all the time.
What? Anybody who's been to an elementary school recognizes what an unsupervised fourth grade recess looks like. Even they have an end and a conclusion.
Exactly.
And some common ground.
Yep.
Just one more thing. So, I attended a meeting last week with Wendy and principal of the school. There were some concerns expressed during the primary that we wanted to address. And we decided that it would be a good idea to have a police officer in uniform at the school during those two big elections that are coming up. So you'll see a slight increase in the budget under the elections and registration salaries line item for the September state election and then the presidential.
So Ben's in the middle there on that, yeah.
So that'll be captured election costs?
Right.
Okay. I'm just thinking out loud about, yeah.
The other update in the budget was the building inspector's code books. We had initially estimated them to be about $700. They actually came in at about $882.
Yeah.
So there's
a lot of
increase that won't be there.
That's right.
So maybe our next agenda, we can talk about the basic snapshots of where we're at with the budget, revenue projected versus expense, and start the gap discussion. But let's roll it out there. Also, if we could, also think about maybe for our next meeting warrant. At least opening it, setting our date. And then the consent articles, we can go through pretty quickly. We can start those processes.
For the first draft, so.
Perfect. Anything else?
The one thing I also like is I'd like to congratulate the all the young men and women that participated in the 27th Sunderland Recreation Basketball Tournament.
Oh, nice.
That's right.
This weekend. Not only them, but the ones that participated. I'd also like to thank the Sunderland Baseball that has organized it all those years, and all the people that helped, Mancake Breakfast. I don't know if people realize the raffle, they have usually 7 or 8 raffle baskets there. I think if people realize what was in the raffle baskets, they would come nothing more to buy a raffle ticket, because they're pretty inexpensive raffle tickets for what you can get in those baskets. Mm-hmm. I just know one of the baskets, I didn't put any tickets in, because if you could won that raffle basket, you'd be working in the yard.
Oh, nice.
So I didn't think that was a good one.
Studiously avoided that one.
Yeah, be one of the ones that had the Red Sox tickets on. So again, I want to thank all of the, congratulate all of the young men and women that participated, the Sunderland Baseball, the rec people, the coaches, and all the players, and parents, grandparents, friends of the families. Guys did a good job.
You think about that opening statement, Tom. 27 years of any kind of those kind of ad hoc, volunteer, or agency-driven, that's just wonderful stuff. So that's a good run for any event, let alone volunteer-driven.
You know, Scott, it's just as important, Scott. They put out a, it's pretty cool, they put out a pamphlet, a score sheet, a scorecard, just like if you went to the Red Sox game, they hand it out to everybody, and lists all the kids' name, the coaches, where they're from. But more importantly, inside there are the businesses and organizations in our community that contribute to that. And if you read it, and I forget how many they print out, but everybody gets a copy that walks in usually. I'd just like to thank those organizations for continue to show their support. And there's probably organizations there that have been doing it for 27 years.
Yep.
So.
That's a wonderful thread in the fabric of our community.
This is a well-entrenched tradition, kind of like our version of March Madness here.
If you ask some of the parents, they would tell you it is March Madness.
Oh yeah, it's their version.
I've been there.
They start Thursday night and they don't go home. So
this is the first time in years I haven't been slinging pancakes back there in the kitchen. So
nice. I appreciate the comments, Tom. That was well done. Anything else to kind of cover tonight? If not, is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Second. We have a motion made and seconded to adjourn. Not hearing any of the discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
3.75. I didn't hear an aye from the.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. 3.75 to 0. Call us out at 7:24. Thank you, everybody.